After the launch of NVIDIA's Blackwell 50 series cards, I noticed something in the specs that wasn't getting enough attention in my opinion, which is the newly added support of 422 chroma subsampling for decoding and encoding. And I get it. From a gamer's perspective, that sentence means nothing. But from a video editor's point of view, that's huge. Let me explain. But first, for disclosure, NVIDIA did provide the RTX 5090 I'm going to be using for these tests and the budget for me to make this video. This isn't just some ad. I actually reached out to NVIDIA when I heard about the 422 support and asked if they would finance this idea, and they were happy to do so. Now, I'm often raving about how much I like using DaVinci Resolve on PC because it really leverages the power of my gaming hardware to improve my video editing performance all on one machine. Using NVIDIA GPUs, I can take the load off my CPU and much more efficiently handle various video files. However, there were always some gaps in that coverage, and looking at NVIDIA's codec support matrix, even as recently as the RTX 4090, you can see the decode support for 10-bit 420 in H.264 and 422 in 8-bit or 10-bit was missing. It was also missing for H.265, 422 in 8-bit or 10-bit. In fact, the only common camera codec you could get 10-bit decode for was H.265, 420. But now let's look at the RTX 50 series. Support all the way across the board. And this doesn't only apply to the RTX 5090, I only chose this card for an apples-to-apples comparison to my 4090. But even the 5070 gets this support, and so do the laptop chips, which might even prove to be the most important since they're usually much more CPU limited, so offsetting that load would have a big impact. Now, I'm going to be showing you some results using a beta version of DaVinci Resolve, but I was informed that Premiere Pro will also be getting an update to take advantage of the 50 series codec support as well. These NLE software updates will also enable added encode options. Previously, if you wanted to use NVENC to export your videos, you couldn't encode using 422 for H.264 or H.265 either. You'd instead have to choose between 420 or 444. Well, 50 series brings 422 support on encode as well, which is great to see. To better demonstrate what I was talking about, I made two little sequences here in DaVinci Resolve, and there's a big label on them so you can see H.264, 10-bit, 422. I recorded these with my Sony Alpha 7 IV, which is a camera that showcases part of this problem, because if you want to shoot an H.264 and you want 10-bit, you have to choose 422. If you choose 420, you're automatically dropped down to 8-bit. So it would be nice if your GPU could match whatever codecs you want to choose in your camera. Right now, I have the 4090 installed, which does not support 422 decode. On this one, it's black and white with some film grain, and then there's going to be a transition. It looks like this, and then it goes to a full color mode, and there's text, and there's, you know, background, and a little bit of blurring, and a little bit of fusion stuff. And we're going to look in this bottom right quadrant here where it says video decode, and also we can take a look at the utilization, and also the CPU utilization up here. So let's go ahead and play this sequence. This is the 10-bit 422, and you can see that there is 0% on the video decode. Nothing's going on over here. Our utilization on the GPU is in the 60s. Sometimes 70%, as you can see there. And our CPU usage seems to go between 10 and 20%, often hovering around 15%. Now let's jump ahead to this sequence, which is the 8-bit 420, which does have decode. And you can see that there's immediately some action going on in the decode section, which even though our GPU utilization remains about the same in that sort of 60%, our CPU utilization goes way down now into single digits, sometimes as low as 4%. Now, I have a powerful CPU. I have an i9-14900K, so these percentage differences might not seem that drastic for me, but that's why I said it's even more important with a lower powered machine or a laptop or something, where the difference between 20% CPU utilization for me could be 60% for a laptop, or it could be the difference between throttling or not throttling and just how it overall feels. And so the fact that we're barely increasing our GPU utilization while significantly reducing our CPU utilization is very, very good and the core reason for doing something like this. There's also a bit of a subjective element here, which is that if I scrub on the one that has the decode, it's just, it's incredibly responsive. I don't know if this is, you know, being conveyed in the video here, but this is really, really good. Or if I scrub over here, it's just, it's a little bit choppier. Again, I have a really, really good CPU, but I can feel it. And when you drop somewhere and start playing, it takes a sort of half second for it to start going, where in this one, it's immediate. And these are only 4K streams. Imagine if you had like two or three 8K cameras, none of which were decodable, and you were cutting back and forth. It's just going to get worse and worse. And then again, that throttling and CPU limitation stuff is just going to really kick in. But now let's switch the GPUs. Let's put the 5090 in here and see what results we get. Okay, we are back now with the RTX 5090 installed. Installation was a breeze. Now, let's run those same tests again and take a look at the numbers. So this is the 10-bit 422, And you can see we're getting some action on the video decode now, where before we were not. And overall GPU utilization is actually quite a bit lower. 40-something percent utilization of the GPU and 6%, 5% on the CPU up here. And when we switch over to the 8-bit 420, the results are exactly the same. So basically, now with a 50 series card, you're going to get the same performance you would get with an 8-bit 420 file, but all the way up to 10-bit 422. Pretty much every codec that I've seen in any of the mirrorless hybrid cameras that I've used seems to be covered by the new support matrix, which is great. Something else I mentioned in the intro that I should show you here too, just as I was about to do this export, you'll notice that when you choose, say, H265 and your encoder NVIDIA, and then you go down to encoding profile, now you'll see options for 422.8 and 422.10. These were never there before. It was like main or main 444, and I think there was the 10-bit option as well. But it's great that you have the full options here. So if you shoot 422, you can export 422. You don't have to sort of export at 444, which is, you know, you're not going to get any gains there, or down subsample to main. You can now keep your project consistent all the way across, whether you want a round trip or deliver like that, which is fantastic to see as well. Hey, so fun update. I was just on the Blackmagic Support Center page, and as you can see, posted today is DaVinci Resolve 20, public beta 1. And if you go into the release notes for that and scroll down, you can see GPU accelerated H265, 422 encodes and decodes on supported NVIDIA systems. So it looks like DaVinci Resolve 20 is going to come with those things baked into it. I'm using a beta version that NVIDIA provided to me, but maybe I'll download this one and see if it's working in the beta. So good news, I just ran a bunch of the tests again using that new Resolve 20 public beta 1, and the results were exactly the same as that special version 19 beta that NVIDIA sent me, which means that if you have a 50 series graphics card or laptop and you use Resolve, might as well download that if you plan to, you know, edit 422 footage, because you'll be able to take advantage of it. By the time this video goes live, it'll all be available for you. And hopefully soon after the Premiere Pro version as well. I do have a few sort of small little benchmarks. I don't do elaborate benchmarks usually for these kinds of things. I ran the Puget Resolve benchmarks. I have a feeling though that they might actually be better when these decode and encode things are accounted for. We went from 11,650 points to 13,287, pretty decent little uplift. And the GPU score itself for the 4090, I got 138, and for the 5090, I got 193. So that's a significant improvement. But what that looks like for an actual video editor, I found that when I exported a video that was mostly using 420 footage, so one that wouldn't really be that big of a difference, we did trim a little bit off our export time, 3 minutes and 25 seconds down to 3 minutes and 14 seconds. And the file size was a little bit better too. Sometimes new versions of NVENC can be slightly more efficient. If we use a video that is filled with 422 footage, like when I do the studio tours, they're primarily shot 422. It went from a 3 minute and 39 second export to a 2 minute and 27 second export. And I was watching the frames per second as it was sort of rendering that footage out. And I was getting about 161 frames per second with the 4090 and 209 frames per second with the 5090. But the majority of that increase, because I also ran it again using a version of Resolve that didn't have support for it, the bulk of that increase came from the decode, not so much the 4090 to the 5090. So the big advantage here, like I said, you don't have to get a 5090. It's just having that decode option, your frame rate on render is going to go up significantly if you have a lot of 422 footage in your project.
Something else that's worth pointing out is the split mode option in your export settings, which right now is set to auto. And if we look at that encode and decode matrix from earlier, right now I have the 3090 up, you can see total number of NVENC, which is the NVIDIA encoders, and there's only one. And if we go to the 4090, we can see that there was two. But now if we look at the 5090, we can see they've actually increased total number of encoders to three. So to fully leverage this, when you go into Resolve, you're gonna wanna change the split mode option from auto to split. And then when you do your export, you should notice a significant performance improvement. I can actually give you a little demonstration of that now. If I put it on auto and you start the export, and then you look up here in the top left corner and you'll see how many frames per second we're getting, which I'm averaging around 130. But now let's go ahead and stop that and then change the split mode to split. And now you can see we're getting well over 200 frames per second because it's fully leveraging the multiple encoders on the 5090. In some cases, this got me a 15 to 20% improvement like it did in my 420 mix project, where I went from 4.5 minutes to 3 minutes and 45 seconds. But in that complete 422 Sony camera footage studio tour project that I had, I saw nearly a 60% improvement going from 3.5 minutes all the way down to 2 minutes by enabling that split encoding mode. That is huge.
Still early days, you know, we're still using beta firmware. First few tests of these things coming out, I expect that support in the NLEs, and it's just going to get better and better and more practical use cases with hardware where you can actually leverage this further than my extreme case where, you know, my CPU could probably handle this if it needed to. But I always love maximizing, you know, efficiency whenever I can. So good job. I'm glad to see, as a mirrorless camera user, that 422 encode and decode is finally available with my NVIDIA GPUs. Plus, now you have an excuse to upgrade your gaming hardware to a 50 series, you know, for business purposes, not for gaming. No, of course not. It's for 422 decode. Yeah, Gerald said it's for 422 decode. That's the only reason why I'm getting it. Cut to me playing Cyberpunk or Elden Ring or something. Just doing some 422 decode down here.
Foul tarnished.
Anyway, thanks to NVIDIA for sending this over. Good job on the new decode options. All right. I'm done.